please stand? He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God, in Him will I trust. Surely He shall deliver thee from the snare of the fowler and from the noisome pestilence. He shall cover thee with His feathers, and under His wings shalt thou trust. His truth shall be thy shield and buckler. Thou shalt not be afraid for the terror by night, nor for the arrow that flieth by day, nor for the pestilence that walketh in darkness, nor for the destruction that wasteth at noonday. 1,000 shall fall at thy side, and 10,000 at thy right hand, but it shall not come nigh thee. Only with thine eyes shalt thou behold and see the reward of the wicked. Because thou hast made the Lord, which is my refuge, even the Most High, thy habitation, there shall no evil befall thee. There neither shall any plague come nigh thy dwelling. For he shall give his angels charge over thee, to keep thee in all thy ways. They shall bear thee up in their hands, lest thou dash thy foot against a stone. Thou shalt tread upon the lion and adder. The young lion and the dragon shalt thou trample under feet. Because he hath set his love upon me, therefore will I deliver him. I will set him on high, because he hath known my name. He shall call upon me, and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. With long life will I satisfy him and show him my salvation. A portion of God's holy words.
Ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters, family members, we are gathered here to put to rest and to remember Brother Horace Burnett, one who has done tremendous good for this cause, and one, as we come today to remember him, we ask that as we go through the service as is on the program. Number two, I'm requesting kindly that the invitees who are speaking, for two reasons. One, and I want to praise God for the rain. It gives a sort of comfort in terms of coolness. However, according to the weather person, rain will come for the entire morning. So I'm asking all the speakers to be very brief. I was made to understand by the family that each person has just 2 minutes maximum time to speak apart from the speaker. We're asking each one to respect that. Another thing I want to let you know is that there's no open tribute on the program, so therefore won't accommodate any at all. Any tribute to be made can be made sometime somewhere else. And finally, I'm asking each person who's participating in the program to watch the program and look for the time that you will come in. Allow me at this time to make one adjustment to the program for the scripture reading. Revelation chapter 21, 1 to 7, that's the first reading. And the second reading, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, 13 to 18. At the appropriate time, I will get up to speak again. Until then, the program will go as is written. I invite you all now to sing the hymn, All the Way My Savior Leads Me.
Thank you.
Our God and our Father, you have brought us here to give thanks for the life of your Son. A father, a brother, a colleague, a church member, a community person. We thank you for what you have done through him for others. We come now to celebrate his life. And we ask that you'll be these family members especially, grant them your peace and your comfort. And may all the things that be done today, not just to give him the praise, but rather give you the praise, and continue to lead out in this session, that we'll do things decently and orderly to your name. For these mercies we ask, in Jesus' name, amen. Please be seated. As the choir is leaving, I'm asking the person for scripture reading. Could they kindly come? Of course, by the eulogy, and the program will continue as is without my intervention.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you for coming. The scripture lesson comes to us from Revelation chapter 21, verses 1 to 7. And I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea.
And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband.
And I heard a great voice saying out of heaven, Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he dwell with them. And they shall be his people, and God himself with them, and be their God.
And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away.
And he sat upon the throne and said, Behold, I make all things new. And he said unto me, Write, for these words are true and faithful.
And he said unto me, It is done. I am the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. I will give unto him that is athirst of the fountain of water of life freely.
He that overcometh shall inherit all things, and I will be his God, and he shall be my son. This is the word of the Lord.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Anika Kandampa. I am niece to Mr. Horace Burnett and Pamela Burnett. Mr. Horace George Burnett was born on March 4, 1953, to Estes and Gladys Burnett in the quiet rural farming district of Springdale, St. Elizabeth. Horace had seven sisters and four brothers. He was the youngest boy in his family. One brother preceded him as well as his parents. During his early life, Mr. Burnett was raised in the new Fulex Moravian Church, where he was very actively engaged in the Boy Scout Club. However, Mr. Burnett later became a member of the Seventh-day Adventist Church in the New Market, St. Elizabeth, and its membership was subsequently transferred to the Maranatha SDA Church, located on Mayday Road in Manchester. His formal education began at the Clapham Primary School in his residential district, where he was a diligent and helpful student. His boyhood pet name was Little Man. Little Man had a serious accident in his childhood, and he suffered third-degree burns to his right foot, but God helped him to overcome. During his teen years, he assisted his father on the farm, and later in his adolescence, he found employment on an animal farm and was busy caring for his farm animals. Though he loved animals, Horace was not satisfied to remain in animal farming as a lifelong profession. And so he studied at an Evelyn Institute and was successful in passing the Jamaica School Certificate examination and gained his entry into West Indies College, now Northern Caribbean University, at age 21 years old. In his academic setting, Mr. Horace Burnett was successful in obtaining a diploma in primary teacher education and was later employed at the Happy Grove All-Age School, where he served as a classroom teacher, senior teacher, and acting principal. He was later employed at the Hatfield All-Age School in Manchester, where he was a classroom teacher and head of department. He continued to climb the academic ladder and gain a Bachelor's of Arts degree in secondary school education from WIC, and later in 2002, a master's degree in business administration from the same institution. This ambitious educator was employed in the Office of the Ministry of Education as a book rental representative and served in the capacity with excellence, and was promoted to be territorial education officer in the Ministry of Education, supervising principals in 29 primary all-age school and junior high and independent schools in Southern St. Elizabeth cluster of schools. He retired from this position in 2010, but continued his part-time and then full-time faculty positions at NCU. Mr. Burnett worked in the teacher education department at NCU under the leadership of the late William Smith, as well as the current teacher education department chair, Dr. Jacqueline Hoshin Clark. This was his final professional employment. Educator Burnett was a people's person. He was a very caring professional and was eager for his students to succeed. He went the extra mile to ensure that his students would not fail his classes. His students loved him immensely and had the utmost respect for him. In his academic arena, he was affectionately called Mr. B. Just about every student wanted to take classes with Mr. B because he was so cool, calm, pleasant, peaceful, and easygoing. He was an excellent Christian teacher educator who demonstrated and consistently utilized the method and practices of Jesus, the master teacher. Teacher Horace Burnett's ultimate purpose was to ensure that his students he interfaced with were fully empowered with the requisite skills and attitudes that would enable them to face the challenges of the 21st century and beyond to become citizens of heaven. Mr. Burnett loved the Lord and served as a church officer for numerous years in the following position: Sabbath school teacher, stewardship director, Adventist youth sponsor, education sponsor, children's divisions leader, church treasurer, assistant church treasurer, first elder, elder, choir director, vacation Bible school instructor, family life director. Little man, Mr. B, Elder Burnett, Mr. Burnett, was the recipient of several awards, including 2021, the NCU Department of Teacher Education Award for excellent service to the work of Christian education. 2016, the Maranatha SDA Church Award for long service. 2015, outstanding work in the church treasury. 2012, Ministry of Education citation for outstanding work in the field of education. 2007, South St. Elizabeth Cluster of Principal Award for outstanding and dedicated service to the cluster. It was while pursuing his diploma at WIC that he met his fellow teacher trainee, Pamela Burnett, my aunt, and he was immediately attracted to her. After friendship, dating, falling in love, and courtship, the two were joined together in holy matrimony on July 31, 1983. Their union produced three offsprings: Camelia, Georgianne, and Horace George Burnett II. Mr. Burnett later became a very proud and happy granddad to his two grandsons, Tayer and Cahill. They gave him much happiness, joy, laughter, and gladness. Mr. Burnett was loved and was very respected by his in-laws. On the fateful morning of May 4th, 2023, Mr. Burnett complained of not feeling well, and efforts to assist him prove futile. He closed his eyes and fell asleep peacefully in Jesus. He is at rest, awaiting the call of the life giver, and his works follows him. He has left behind his dear wife, Pamela, children, grandchildren, sibling, nieces, nephews, and lots of relatives, friends, students, co-workers, and a very large church family. The golden morning is fast approaching. Jesus will soon come.
Mighty rushing wind, and it's closer now than it's ever been. I can almost hear the trumpet, it's Gabriel's sound. is the call. Oh, at the midnight cry, we'll be going home. See, when Jesus steps up, when Jesus comes again. I'll crown me, I see prophecies all fulfilling, and the signs of the time, they're showing everywhere. I can almost hear the Father as he said, "Son, you better go get my children." The bride of Christ will rise. So when Jesus steps out on the clouds to call its children, the dead in Christ, they shall rise, they shall rise. And then those that remain will be quickly changed. Yes, they will be changed. Oh, at the midnight cry, when Jesus comes again. When Jesus comes again, at the midnight cry, when Jesus comes again, when Jesus comes again.
The scripture lesson is taken from 1 Thessalonians 4, chapter 4, verse 13 to 18. But I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that ye sorrow not, even others which have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them also which sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. For the Lord himself shall descend from the heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. Wherefore, comfort one another with these words.
It is my distinct pleasure to introduce to you the person who will be giving the homily. It is Pastor Cheyenne, Pastor Dr. Cheyenne O'Connor, former pastor of the Maranatha District of Churches, of which Elder Burnett was a member. Dr. O'Connor is now the pastor and clinical psychologist for the Cayman Islands. I pray for him from you, your undivided attention, and ask that you whisper prayer in your hearts as he share a word of comfort and encouragement. Before he comes, though, the Mandeville Men's Chorale will give the song of meditation.
When we're So I watched the funeral service for Patrick Smith just a few weeks ago. And I took note that it was right here. And so I sat there a while ago and said, okay, so we're back here again. And then when I woke up this morning, somehow I started to check. Sister Jackie, in that little subdivision down the road, the College View subdivision, where all college workers have their, most have their houses, some, right beside me, Sister Harris Henry is dead. Two houses down, Mrs. Rose is dead. Just maybe two houses across the street is Patrick Smith, is dead. One house up the road, Pastor Terence Milford, dead. They skip over you, Jackie. And it dawned on me that the saints are going home. One by one, the saints are going home. We're getting very much familiar with death and funeral services. And so yesterday I was in town asking about some folks at Maranatha. I asked for Sister Shields, the famous Sister Shields, dead. I asked for Sister Lunan, dead. Brother Lunan, dead. And maybe there are many others who are dead. So it's very clear that the Lord is taking home his children one by one. And today, my friend and brother and former member, Horace, is dead. And the question is, who is next? Who is next? Let me leave you to ponder that as I express gratitude to Pam and the family for extending an invitation to my wife and myself to share in this service. Horace is still here. It's tattered, battered, and bruised. It was given to me by Sister Lewis, who used to live up the hill. She died as well. Yes, she 1992, we did a campaign. Sister Lewis gave this Bible to me. And that was, I don't know how many years have passed, but I have worked the Bible and worked the Bible every campaign. This is my evangelistic tool. It's just coming from Negril. If you see, it's mashed up and tattered. It's coming from Negril. I haven't reached home as yet. It just came up yesterday after a 4 weeks campaign. It is this. Pastor Brown, this Bible has been recreated a couple times, well, remodeled, and it's bruised again. And I can't get rid of it because it has been a source of life for me. I can't number the amount of souls that have been won through this Bible given to me by Sister Lewis at Maranatha Church. The district is close to my heart. I have one old ministerial manual. Didn't get it from the conference. It was also given to me by one Pastor Holmes. Anybody know about Pastor Holmes? Yeah, Pastor Holmes was the supervisor for that area. So I'm equipped for ministry from Maranatha. Come on, say amen. Both the Bible and the ministerial manual. Praise the Lord. So when Maranatha calls, I have to respond. And this is a critical call for us. So let me again extend my condolences to the entire family and to Sister Pam and all the members of the family, my wife and I. And I also would like to, I can't go back to the Cayman Islands if I do not extend condolences because they are watching, on behalf of Dr. Joan Latty and her dear husband. They have called this morning asking me please to extend condolences. They would have loved to be here in person, but I'm sure they are praying for you. So for the next few minutes that Pastor Gregory allotted me, let me use the opportunity wisely. First, recognize the presence of my home conference president, Pastor Neville, and my home union president, Pastor Brown. When I come back to Jamaica, I realize I'm at home. Question for you. Why is it when our favorite pet dies, we do not keep a funeral service? When our dogs die, when our cats die, when our fish dies, we don't keep a funeral service. Why is it that we only keep funeral services for humans? When our donkeys die, when our cows die, when our most valuable animal dies, we don't have an official funeral service where folks dress up and come and we have a sermon. Why? Why is it only for us? And I have to ask a question. If that, as you ponder that, what's the reason why we have funeral services when a person dies? Why not just that we don't need to be here? Because many of you have already called and visited and extend your condolences and give words of comfort. So it could not be just that. Maybe it is, as they told us at college when I was training, maybe it's not just to comfort the bereaved, but it's to speak well of the dead. But if that is so, then it's a waste of time. Why? Because everybody here is either family member or close relative of Horace. And so whatever we're going to say about Horace, most people already know, because we are not strangers. So we already know. So what's the reason we're having a funeral service? I took a look at Jesus and his attendance to funeral services. And noted that when Lazarus died, one of the remarks that Jesus made was a very unusual remark. Jesus says, Lazarus is dead, and I'm glad, number one. And number two, he said, and when he told the disciples that Lazarus, you know, is dead, and they had a little problem believing, he says, Lazarus is dead so that the Son of God might be glorified. Ooh! Hang on. Lazarus is dead so that the Son of God might be glorified. And then I began to wonder, is it only the death of Lazarus that glorifies God, or is it generally applicable to all of God's children? In other words, can we safely say that when a friend of God dies, i.e. Lazarus was a friend, can we say when a child of God dies that God is glorified? Can God be glorified, put it another way, can God be glorified through the death of his saints? And if that is so, if that has a general applicability, yeah, if that is not just unique to Lazarus, which I am suggest that is not just unique to Lazarus, I'm suggesting that whenever a child of God dies, there's an opportunity in that death for God to be glorified. And if that is so, to what extent does our funeral services glorify God? And if that is so, understand then that funeral services is not necessarily to relieve the mourning and the grieving of family members. It's not necessarily designed to speak well of the dead. It is designed that God might be glorified. And if that is so, how then do we do that? How then do we accomplish that? How then can God be glorified? So I took a little look. I took a little look at Jesus when he attends funeral services or the home where death is present. And it struck me, and it probably should do you also, that when Jesus turns up at a funeral service, i.e. the widow at Nain and her son, whichever of them, Jesus doesn't, watch the preacher, Jesus doesn't go to the funeral service to join the mourners. Amen. He doesn't go there to extend condolences. Hey, watch the preacher. Jesus don't even go there to give hope. Did he just say that? Yes. Jesus doesn't attend funeral services to give hope. When Jesus attends funeral services, his purpose there is to establish credibility in the Almighty. I think that when Jesus goes to a funeral service, right? Any funeral, anytime Jesus arrives where death is, he's there to change the situation, to bring back life where there was death. And he does that so that the people around may understand that he is who he said he is. And so that the people around may understand that he's a resurrector and he's a life giver and he's a son of the living God. You didn't get me. So that when Jesus leaves the funeral service, everybody in attendance now fall in love with this man and wants to be a part of this man. How can we make our funeral service, when it is finished, everybody fall in love with God again and want to be part of God's family again? He went to the Jairus' house. He did the same thing. How do we make our funeral services bring honor and glory to God? How do we do that? How do we allow people who attend funeral service? Hey, what's the preacher? How do we allow people who attend funeral service to go home and ask themselves the question, Lord, is it well with me? Not that, oh, we had a wonderful funeral service today. Did you hear how that guy sings? How do we go home and check our own relationship with God so that the funeral services draw somebody closer to him? So in the next few minutes that I have, I'm going to show you what the Lord revealed to me. There's a text. And there are a lot of preachers here. I'm going to ask their permission. There's a text in the book of Hebrews. If you have your Bible still, if you still carry Bibles, the funeral service. People don't anymore. People do not. It's on your phone, right? Pull it out. I'm sorry, I'm coming from a campaign. The evangelistic spirit is still in me. Pull it out. On your phone, pull it out. It's in Hebrews chapter 9. Yeah, it's Hebrews chapter 9. Look at it, because I want you to look at it. Hebrews chapter 9, and it's in verse 27. Look at it on your phone, if you have it on your phone. Or if you have the good old Bible like me, you can find it. Hebrews 9, verse 27. Here's the author. Well, I agree with Ellen White, it's Paul. Some people are still debating it. The author writes, and as it is, come on, if you guys have it, could you just talk back to the preacher here? Let's read together. And as it is appointed unto man once to die, but after this is what? The judgment. Ooh. Hang on. I have preached from this text, Sister Jackie, a million times. I have preached from this text several funeral services, several evangelistic campaigns, Pastor Barrett. And the text did not talk to me until the day before yesterday. Then the text talked back to me. Do you want to hear what the text says? The text says, look at what is written. So I look. And what is written says, after death is the judgment. So I said to the text, yeah, see it. Okay. But then the text says, but that's not what you have been preaching. What do you mean? Oh, what we have been preaching is that after death comes a resurrection. Oh. Oh. And then I realized almost every funeral service I attend and almost every funeral service I preach, our focus has always been on the certainty of the resurrection. Including myself. We have always, every funeral service, we've always preached on the resurrection because there's a lot of stuff to talk about the resurrection. There was a controversy between the Pharisees and the Sadducees over resurrection, and that's why Jesus dealt with it and made it clear, I am the resurrection and I'm the life, and if you believe in me in the last days, I will raise you up. Jesus dealt with it, and Paul dealt with it at length. Paul says, if Christ is not raised, then there will be no resurrection. And so Paul gave a whole dissertation on the subject of resurrection and gave reason why there had to be witnesses at Christ's resurrection. Not just Mary, not just the disciples, not just the two guys on the road to Emmaus. But Paul says 500 people saw him all at the same time. Paul established the fact that there is going to be a resurrection. And everybody at the funeral service left feeling good that there's going to be a resurrection. Can I talk to you members of the church this evening? Listen to the preacher. Right now at NCU, right now in our church, right now in this community, we have no problem believing that there's going to be a resurrection. That's not our issue. Everybody agrees that there's going to be a resurrection because there's going to be one. But the emphasis, Paul says, is not on the resurrection. Hey, hear the preacher. There cannot be no resurrection without a judgment. In other words, whether you're good or bad, you're going to be raised. Whether Horace was good or bad, there's going to be a resurrection. Oh, you didn't know that? Yeah. Don't worry. Don't worry about resurrection. You're going to be raised. Either in the first. Oh, Lord have mercy. The Bible says there are two resurrections. Am I right? Yes. Paul in 1 Thessalonians 4 verse 16. The dead in Christ shall rise first. And then Revelation says 1,000 years after, the rest of the dead will rise. Amen. So whether you're in the first or you're in the second, you're going to come back up. So the resurrection is not the issue. It's not the issue. To focus on resurrection is to major in the minor. The problem is the judgment. Because it is the judgment that determines which of the two resurrections you come up in. Ay, 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 ay. So rather than leaving feeling very happy that I will be raised, the question is, how shall you stand in the judgment? The text spoke to me. Paul says, after death, the judgment. There is no intervening event. In other words, the judgment is the only intervening event between death and resurrection. Is the church with me? So if that is so, then my next question to you before you go home, what is this judgment? And what does it have to do with death? And then I send you home. What is this? Hey, since this judgment is so critical, what it is? And what does it have to do with death? And the problem dealing with judgment is that hardly anybody wants to hear about it. Including Felix. That's a subject we can put off till we have more convenient time. And yet, it is more certain than death. And yet people plan for their death and buy burial spot long before they die. But nobody planned for their judgment. So what is this judgment? Quickly, let me just tell you what this judgment is. I'll give you a little peep into it. Quickly. In Daniel, I'm happy you brought your Bible with you. So in Daniel chapter 7 and verse 9, just a little peep. If I have raised your interest, then that's what I want to happen. Daniel 7 verse 9. Here's what the text says. Daniel got a view of the judgment, and he documented it. And here's what he said. I'm in Daniel 7, verse 9 down. He says, I watched till thrones were put in place. The Ancient of Days was seated. His garment was white as snow. His hair as a head of his head was like pure wool. His throne was a fiery flame, its wheels a burning fire. A fire stream issued and came forth from before him. Here's what I'm interested in. 1,000,000 ministered to him. 10,000 times 10,000 stood before him. Here's it coming up. The court was seated, comma, and the books were open. Books were open. Let me say to these folks over here. And the books were open. So right now your brain should be asking, what books? And what is in it? What does it have to do with me? I'm glad you asked, because in Revelation, John saw the similar judgment. And John gave something very interesting. Revelation chapter 20, I mean verse 5. Turn your phones there. Your devices. I gotta get used to it. I can't say turn your Bible anymore. Turn your devices. Revelation chapter 20. I'm in verse. Let's see what. Here's what the Bible says. In Revelation 20. Is the church there? Are you guys here? Yes. Verse 11. Let's go verse 11. John says, then I saw a great white throne and him who sat on it, from whose face the earth and the heaven fled away, and there was found no place for them. Verse 12. And I saw, here's the dead coming. And I saw the dead, small dead, great dead, standing before God. And here's it coming now. And again, John says, as Daniel said, the books were open. Then John said, I saw another book was open, which is the book of life. And take your time and read this stuff. And the dead, if you ask what the relationship between dead and judgment, and the dead were judged according to their works by the things which were written in the books. Coming on. The dead were judged by their works according to the things that were written in the books. So let me put it back again. Hey, if you don't catch this message, catch it now. There is a bookkeeper in heaven. And he records all transactions of our lives, documented in books. For if it is not written, it didn't happen. Hey. Let me give you Ellen White. Great controversy. Page 482. Are you ready for this? Opposite each name in the books of heaven is entered with terrible exactness. Terrible exactness. What? Every wrong word, every selfish act, every unfulfilled duty, every secret sin, with terrible exactness. There's a bookkeeper in heaven. If I were to encapsulate this little presentation, I would call it the bookkeeper. And by the way, you can't bribe him. You can't sweet talk him. He's not subject to bribe, subject to treat. Are you with me? With terrible exactness. Everything we say. Solomon in the book Ecclesiastes says, every secret thing, whether they be good or bad, is documented against our name in the books of heaven. So what does that have to do with that? When we breathe our last breath, then the bookkeeper put down his pen and paper. Because nothing more can be added to the account. No adjustment. Are you with me? No correction. Not even an addendum. So the big question is for Horace, what's in his book? Is it sufficient enough to take him through the pearly gates? Is it enough? Because if it's not enough, there's nothing we can do right now. Because the book is closed. So, if what, I'm going to finish right now. Can I get just 5 more minutes? 5 more minutes? All in favor say aye. All opposed by the same sign, scarred. Five more minutes. So my friend Horace can't hear me. But I know that he knew what I'm about to say to you. Amen. That if there's something in his book that would create a problem for him to pass through the pearly gates, I know that Horace knew what to do. Hey. Amen. Yeah. Because Horace spent all his life in church, because Horace know God personally, know his Bible, he knows that if there's something on his record that would be a problem, he knows that all he had to do is have a little talk with Jesus. And the blood of Christ, will cover his sins. Not only cover it, the Bible said, they will be remembered no more. So I'm not worried for Horace, because I know that he has knowledge how to get himself through the pearly gates. I'm worried about you, who may not know. So the question then, what about your record? Is it enough to carry you through the pearly gates? In spite of the years you have been in church? Are there stuff on your record you don't want to see in the judgment? And if there are, then hear the preacher as I wrap up. If there are stuff in your record that you don't want to see in judgment, if there are stuff on your record that you think will create a problem for you to pass through the pearly gates, if there are stuff on your record that will send you to the second resurrection and you want to change that, hear the preacher. As long as you have life, the bookkeeper is still writing. You have an opportunity, to apply for some correction. So my challenge to you, my charge to you is do it now. Do what David did. David says, Lord, creating me a clean heart and renew the right spirit from me. And then David made one interesting statement that I looked over. He says, and do not blot me out. Ooh. Instead, what he asked God to do was to, quote, blot out my blot out my transgression. And as long as mercy door is still open, as long as the high priest still sitting in his office, as long as you are living, you can get that opportunity to ask God, blot out my transgression. And I want this congregation to use the death of Horace to draw a little closer to God. Prepare your soul and ask God, Lord, there may be some stuff there. How many of you want to say, Lord, just check my record again and see if there be any wicked ways in me, and cleanse me from every sin and set me free? How many want to do that? Stand on your feet if you want to say, Lord, check my record, check my record. Search me, oh God, and know. Oh, try me, dare say. Oh, no, I pray. Some wicked ways in me. Cleanse me from every sin and set me. We don't want that only to be a song. We want it to be a cry from your heart. Because if we're going to see Horace again, then our records have also to be expunged. So I'm going to pray for you even now. Oh God, it is not by accident why we are here today. You purpose that we should be. And Lord, it is true that we may very well be, our record at the church level may be okay, but our record in heaven may be different. And so we stand on our feet this afternoon to ask you, please, turn the pages of our records. And if there's anything, Lord, that would stop us from making it through the pearly gates, if there's anything, Jesus, that would categorize us in the second resurrection, if there's anything, Lord, things that we're conscious of or things that we don't even remember, if there's anything that would put our soul in trouble, we are applying for grace today. We are applying for your blood today. We're asking, forgive us, God, and cleanse us from all unrighteousness, so that when you come, we all will be in the number. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Much, and permit me to express sincere condolences to the bereaved family on behalf of my own family. It was Theodore Roosevelt who said, to educate a person in mind, but not in morals, is to educate manners to society. It is to this philosophy that Elder Horace Burnett is adding a practical demonstration by establishing the Horace Burnett Senior Scholarship Fund that will assist needy students in achieving a Seventh-day Adventist Christian education in order to minimize the menace in our society while advancing moral standards. Elder Burnett's biblical appreciation for Seventh-day Adventist Christian education is highlighted in Psalm 25, 4 and 5, where he says, "Show me your ways, Lord. Teach me your path. Guide me in your truth and teach me, for you are God, my Savior, and my hope is in you all day long." In the book Education, page 225, one of my favorite authors in Christian education said, "True education does not ignore the value of scientific knowledge or literary acquirements, but above information, it values power, above power, goodness, above intellectual acquirements, character." As an educator himself, to what better segment of human aspiration Elder Burnett would contribute? This legacy will change the landscape of poverty for many families. This fund will transform the economic and moral standards of living for generations to come. It is against this background that I now declare the official launch of the Horace Burnett Senior Scholarship Fund. Your liberal offering and pledges will certainly strengthen the foundation of this worthy venture that will go far beyond your lifetime in preparing men and women for eternity. During this time of your generous giving, Mr. Garfield Forbes and Pastor Anthony Downing, in that order, will energize and inspire your heart. Thank you.
Last night I lay asleeping, there came a dream so fair. I stood in old Jerusalem beside the temple there. I heard the children singing, and ever as they sang, methought the voice of angels from heaven in answer rang. Methought the voice of angels from heaven in answer rang. Jerusalem, Jerusalem, lift up your gates and sing. Hosanna in the highest, Hosanna to your King. And then methought my dream was changed, the streets no longer rang. Hushed were the glad hosannas, the little children sang. The sun grew dark with mystery, the morn was cold and chill, as the shadow of a cross arose upon a lonely hill. As the shadow of a cross arose upon a lonely hill. hark how the angels sang, Hosanna in the highest, Hosanna to your King. Once again the scene was changed, new earth there seemed to be. I saw that whole city beside the tideless sea. The light of God was on the streets, the gates were opened wide, and all who would might enter, and no one was denied. No need for moon nor stars by night, or sun to shine by day. It was the new Jerusalem that would not pass away. It was the new Jerusalem that would not pass away. Jerusalem, sing, for the night is o'er. Hosanna in the highest, Hosanna forevermore. Hosanna in the highest, Hosanna forevermore.
All walked away, nothing to say. They just lost their dearest friend. All that he said, now he was dead. So this was the way it ended. The dreams they had dreamed were not what they seemed. Now that he was dead and gone, the garden, the jail, the hammer, the nail, how could a night be so long? Then came the morning, night turning to day. The stone was rolled away. Hope rose with the dawn. Then came the morning. Shadows vanished before the sun. Death had lost and life has won, for morning had come. The angels, the star, the king from afar, the wedding, the water, the wine. Now it was done, they'd taken her son, wasted before its time. She knew it was true, she watched him die too. She'd heard them call him just a man. But deep in her heart, she knew from the start, somehow her son will live again. Then came the morning, not turning to day. The stone was rolled. Death had lost and life had won, for morning had come. Then came the morning, night turning to day. The stone was rolled away, hope rose with the dawn.
As we are, and give thanks for the launch of the Horace Scholarship Fund, Horace Burnett Scholarship Fund, and your tangible contribution. Let us pray. Father, we want to thank you for life. We want to thank you for that of your beloved son, Ella Burnett. We thank you for his kind heart and his consideration for those needy students, those needy ones who will be left behind and need help to continue, to reach the path that he had reached, and maybe to escalate faster than he did and to reach higher on the social ladder. We ask even now that you will consecrate this fund and that it will grow. Others will contribute to it. And the experience that he did not see while he was alive will certainly be a part of the life of others who benefit from this fund. May your Holy Spirit be with us. And for those who contributed, we ask, Lord, that you will continue to bless them to this cause, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
How are you all doing so far? Good? I just want to give one simple recommendation. The room is warm, but to keep cool, you can't fan yourself. Can I say it again? To keep cool, you cannot fan yourself. So if you have a nice neighbor who would want to be hot and keep you cool, then they can do that. The logical thing, once you burn calorie by moving, you're going to get hot. So ask someone to fan you and you remain cool, all right? I don't know who will do it, because each one wants to feel what? Cool. But that's where we are at. Let me just make a slight adjustment here, because this is the area that we have some challenges sometimes. According to my reckoning, we're looking for 2 hours. We're a bit behind. And we have 12 condolences, 5 tributes. Do the math. 2 by what? 17, 34 minutes. That's what we have. That would put us about, say, 12:10. No, sorry, 1:10. 1:10. We'll work with that. We have a slight change. Dr. Jacqueline Clark and her team, of which Brother Burnett was a member of, one member of the team will have to get to Spanish Town to take part in the program. So I'm going to ask her as soon as I sit that she along with her team will come forward. After that, we'll go in the order as in the program, Jamaica Union, all the way down. We're not too sure if all these people are here. So my recommendation is the floor manager is there, and she will try her best to try to get these individuals up in that order. But we run it, and please work with the time that is allotted, 2 minutes each. Thank you very much. Dr. Clark.
Okay, so it's good afternoon, everyone. It's after 12. We are Mr. Burnett's professional family. Mr. Burnett belonged to us at Teacher Education Department. We call ourselves TED, T-E-D, Teacher Education Department. Mr. Burnett belonged to the Maranatha Seventh-day Adventist Church, too. And so, we are sharing in a love affair. Long ago, there was a song that said, mark you, I do not subscribe to the lyrics, but for the purpose of what I'm trying to say, I'm going to tell you. There was a song long ago, when I was a girl, it said, I would like you and my sweetheart to be friends. That's the only way your jealousy will end. So Maranatha and TED, we share the same sweetheart. So let's be friends. This funeral is about TED and Maranatha. Our sweetheart is asleep. We didn't look forward to today at all, but we have to face the reality. So having settled that sweetheart issue, let's get to the tribute. Mr. B was an excellent team player. He created the perfect balance with his unique because he was one who delighted in pleasing everybody. He was a nice man. If you can call a man lovely and sweet, that was Mr. Burnett. Beautiful man, that was Mr. Burnett. He sought to satisfy students. He was student-centered. He cared about the emotions of people. He didn't want anybody to feel bad. Just wanted everybody to feel okay. He cared deeply for others. His office was close to mine. In the department, we have a section that the sun shines in on. And we call it the Sunshine what?
Avenue.
Sunshine Avenue. You see, they know it. And the other side, the sun doesn't come in there. But the Sunshine Avenue was where everybody from the other side would converge and have conversations, all kinds of talks. We talked about the beast and the birds. We talked about the politics of Jamaica. We talked about which party going to win next and who I should vote for. Mr. Burnett would take me to vote and say, "Doctor, you have to vote. Vote, this one going to win." And I would obey him. But then you had people in the department who were on two sides of the fence. And so there were some heated talks, but we were loving still, you know? That was Mr. Burnett. We had a wonderful life in TED. He was student-centered. I often would listen. I didn't have to eavesdrop Marky to listen what was happening in his office. I was that close. And when students would go to Mr. Burnett at the end of exams or sectionals or quiz or whatever, hear Mr. Burnett, "How you like your grade? You satisfied?" Yes. He just wanted them to feel good. And sometimes they're not satisfied, you know. And I would sit there and hear the negotiation going on, you know. Yes! Mr. Burnett just wanted to keep everybody happy. At TED, in TED, he was not a disciplinarian. Because remember now, you know, he don't want anybody vexed with him, right? So when students are goofing around, when they're fooling around, you know what he used to do? Take them to me. Yes, because nobody must vex Mr. Burnett, you know. So he would come to me. I have an open door policy. You can't just walk into my office. I am not formal. I'm very informal. I don't like formality at all. You walk in. So he would walk in with the students, you know. And hear Mr. Burnett now. He would put down the English language because he was good at the Jamaican language, you know. He would come in and he would say, "This time now, doctor is doctor, a care-reaching doctor." And he would come in with the students and he would put down the English and he would say, "Doctor, I want you to draw up this one. Draw him up, doctor. I'm not serious about school. How do you mean for me? Shake him up." So I would draw him in and shake him up, as Mr. Burnett suggests. And then after Mr. Burnett would leave my office, you can imagine I would break up in laughter. I would just throw my head back and laugh at the fact that he meant them well, but he just never had that personality to draw them up and shake them up. So he took them to me every time. And I would do a good job at it, you know. Because you know what I found? The women in TED were the ones with the ability to draw them and shake them. But the men, I had three men in TED, you know, three of them. Two of them up here. Come up, come, let me make them steal. Come, you come. See the other two here? These are the other two. They were made of the same fabric that made Mr. Burnett. Nobody not vexed with them, you know. When you talk about nice men, see them here, put your hands together for the nice men. Nice men instead. Mr. Forbes and Mr. Panton and Mr. Burnett. Nice men. I tell you, we had a real good time with Sir B. He made me haul them up and shake them up. He was cool and easy, cooler than cucumber. And I'll just hug him up. I'm gonna hug him, he's my friend. He was cooler than cucumber, easier than Sunday morning. I could depend answer be to be cooperative? He literally got along with every student. I am yet to find one record where a single student failed Mr. Burnett's class. Nobody fails Mr. Burnett's class. We will certainly miss him. Long after his retirement, he was still working for us part-time. He has finally closed his books. The educator has closed his books, and he's now sleeping. He's awaiting the golden morning, because all his life, he has been dreaming of a city. He has been dreaming of a city, the New Jerusalem. God bless you. Thank you.
You have a song to
dreaming of a city far beyond the sky, when the suffering's over. Jerusalem, Jerusalem, Jerusalem. I've been dreaming of the city, Jerusalem, my home right up in the sky. Oh, sometimes I lose direction. Satan clouds my mind, but Jesus stands to remind me that I'm passing through. Instead of losing heaven, I must look to the day where there's no more dreaming. I'll be home at last. I've been dreaming of a city, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, Jerusalem. I've been dreaming of the city, Jerusalem, my home right up in the sky. Dreaming of the city, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, Jerusalem. I've been dreaming of the city, Jerusalem, my home right up in the sky.
Dr. Clark is very smart. She talked about sweetheart, referring to herself, to Ted and Marin Arthur. Now the question is, I don't know how many sweethearts he has, so I'm strongly recommending the others, please don't walk in the step of the first sweetheart. Please, please. So let's see what happens from here. I crave your indulgence, ladies and gentlemen, as we try to make the adjustment. Thank you very much, but I beg of those who are coming, let's stick with the time. Thank you.
The Jamaica Union Conference of Seventh-day Adventists, our president and rest of the members of the administration, we join with you, Pastor Neville, President of Central Jamaica Conference, and the members of the bereaved family, Sister Pamela and the children, and more so all the elders of the Maranatha Church and the elders of the Central Jamaica Conference and members who were privileged to have a stalwart of an elder, one who demonstrated what servant leadership was all about. He contributed significantly to the growth and development of the church in Jamaica. And for this, we want the family members and everyone to know that our prayers are with you.
Pastor Everett Brown, President of Jamaica Union Conference, other officiating ministers on the platform, Mr. Robert Miller, a member of Parliament, members of the bereaved family. I, on behalf of the Central Jamaica Conference family, I'd like to express sincere condolences to you, Sister Burnett, and all the other members of the family. You know, it's a sad time for you. It's also a sad time for all of us in Central Jamaica Conference. We are feeling your pain, and we are feeling your sorrow. There's a void that all what we have said here cannot fail. But we serve a mighty God who knows and who can identify with your pain at this time. Permit me, ladies and gentlemen, a minute. I would not miss this funeral service, even if I weren't serving in the capacity that I'm serving now. While I was here on campus, Elder Burnett and I, we studied together, accounts and economics. And he was always the teacher. Outside of class, we would meet on Sunday. And those of you who worked as working students, you know what it is like. After we'd finish studying, he would take us home and feed us with Sunday dinner. A loving and caring man of God. I had a distinct privilege as well of worshiping at the Maranatha Church where he served as an elder, and Pastor Billy, our vice president, is here to attest to that. One who is very passionate about the work of God, and the same teaching skill, he brought it into the work as he taught the members. We're happy for the ministry that he led during his time here. He has touched and impacted all lives. We're missing him as a conference, and we know you are too. But we have hope that one day they're gonna die and Jesus will come to call his children home. We're looking forward to seeing our dear Elder Burnett. Until then, stay sweet in Jesus.
The Bible says, blessed are those who die in the Lord. On behalf of West Jamaica Conference, which is led by Pastor Glenn Samuels, to the Burnett's family, please accept our heartfelt and most profound condolences at this time. Today we are gathered here to recognize the outstanding work that Sir Burnett has given to Adventist Christian education, and also to thank God for lending him to us. The church and education today needs a stalwart like him. Those who will not fail at their duties and commitment. Those who are dependable, true, and honest. Those who will stand for integrity. Those who recognize the sacredness of family ties and will endeavor under God to serve their families well, the church, and also their country. Today, as we reminisce on a life well lived, I pray all of us will take a page out of Sir Burnett's book. To Sister Pamela and the children, please accept our heartfelt condolences, and we'd like you to know that God is with you. West Jamaica is also praying for you, and other siblings who have come here, I can identify Sister Joan Burnett and also Scott Burnett, who served in West Jamaica Conference, and other members of the family, our heartfelt condolences. And I say to all of us, to you and to all of us who are in this place, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Man's today is about to give way to God's tomorrow.
I had to be here today, this morning, at a joint select committee of parliament for the Teachers Education Commission Bill. Also, I had two graduations and I have to leave for three more graduations in the constituency that I represent. But when I started Northern Caribbean University in the Teachers Education Department, we were blessed to have some fine young men as Dr. Clark stated, Mr. Panton, Mr. Forbes, Mr. Miles, I've seen him over there, the late Milford, Dr. Milford, and Dr. Smith, and with no lease, Sir Burnett. I did the course with him, Business Research Methods, and in that course, all of us got a good grade. Mr. Burnett would accommodate us as students. He's very open to us, and we would negotiate with him. He's also a tickler of time, and he's always early and present for class, and that's a good trait of a lecturer. I was sandwiched in which I got the privilege to being taught by Miss Burnett and Mr. Burnett, and indeed, they are two fine lecturers. Mr. Burnett was passionate about male leadership in the classroom. He was passionate about the ethical issues, and of course, we had our discourse with our political views, which was similar to mine. And of course, we spoke about our Jamaica land we love. I bring before you a true man, a father, an elder who have served his church well. And let me give condolences to the family of the bereaved, to let you know that we as past students, that our prayers are with you, and we continue to pray for you. And until then, let our hearts continue singing till we wait on Christ to come, when we will be reunited with our brother yet again. I thank you.
Mr. Moderator, officiating pastors, members of the bereaved family, well wishers all, good day. My name is Reuben Gray, and I'm a former member of the staff of the Ministry of Education here in Region 5. I retired in 2007, the time when Mr. Burnett was a part of the Ministry of Education. The staff of the Ministry of Education is indeed honoring me at this time to allow me to speak on behalf of our departed brother. Mr. Burnett was a treasured member of the Ministry of Education's regional staff. We experienced a certain level of camaraderie among our members, and Horace was a part of the epicenter of that relationship. He knew how to relate to the internal staff, and he was a guiding hand among the principals of his territory. He was a problem solver and one who made meaningful suggestions to the overall management of the educational process in the region. He was committed, dedicated, and took seriously the mandate that was given to him. He never flinched at the task at hand. His senior education officer, and certainly the director, could depend on him to carry out his goals and objectives of the ministry. Horace carried a smile, another frown, as he carried through the daily tasks. Nothing flustered him, nothing ruffled him. He was a beacon of stability in the office. Obviously, Horace was a family man and a devout Christian. He did let his light shine before men that they could see his good works and were led to glorify Christ here on earth. Yet he did not allow his denominational beliefs to get in the way of his work. He was a Christian par excellence, and his life's work demonstrated it. Today, I am under the weather, but nothing would allow me not to speak on behalf of our departed brother. Horace's legacy lives after him as he now rests from his labors. It was Francis Beaumont who said in The Humorous Lieutenant, and I quote, "Let no man fear to die. We have to sleep all, and death is best, the sounder sleep." Yes, Jesus said of Lazarus, "He sleepeth." Mary thought that Lazarus stinketh, but thank God, Jesus is the resurrection and the life, and he demonstrated it at Lazarus' graveside. Yes, Horace will live again. Let us prepare our hearts to meet him again. Condolences to the family from the old and new staff of the Ministry of Education, Region 5, and indeed from the Retired Education Officers Association. Rest well, my brother.
Good afternoon, everyone. I must apologize on behalf of our acting regional director, Mrs. Neverdeen Miller, who is unavoidable absent. But we are here today to represent the Ministry of Education. I'm going to cut it very short, since we allow Mr. Gray a part of the time. So we're just going to tell you about his service. So Mr. Burnett sojourned as an educator in the region of Champions, spanned and varied levels and time in the education system. He served in the following areas: as a classroom teacher at Happy Grove in St. Elizabeth from September 1978 to August 1984. As a classroom teacher from September 1984 to August 1988, he served as a senior teacher and acting principal for one term. Then he became a senior teacher at Hatfield Primary and Junior High from 1988 to April 1996. Then he moved on as an education officer as in the SSTP program from June 1996 to March 1998. Then he went on to be the curriculum support education officer from April 1998 to April 2004. Then as a territorial education officer from June 2004 to June 2010. Mr. Burnett then proceeded on retirement from the government teaching services in June 2010, after 32 years of selfless service to the field of education. We miss him dearly, but one thing we know, if we continue to be faithful to the Lord, we'll meet him by the river some sweet day.
God's children too long have been burdened. They're longing for heaven's green shore, where heartaches are left far behind them. And burdens are carried no more. Come morning, I'll walk by the river. I'll rest 'neath the evergreen tree. So I'll carry my cross through the midnight. Come morning, there's glory for me. Sometimes I'm despised and rejected. And I question, oh Father, how long? Then I take one more look at Calvary. And it gives me the strength to go on. Walk by the river. I'll rest neath the evergreen tree. So I carry my cross through the midnight. Come morning, there's glory for me. Come morning, I walk by the river. I'll rest beneath the evergreen tree. So I'll carry my cross through the midnight. Come morning, there's glory for me.
Our president is unavoidably absent. He has, however, sent a prepared speech, which I'm privileged to read. So here is a tribute from the president of Northern Caribbean University, Dr. Lincoln Edwards. Today, we are gathered to celebrate the life of the late Horace Burnett, who was a husband, father, and grandfather, church elder, and an active member of the Woodlawn Community Citizens Association, mentor and a friend to many, and an alumnus and faculty member of the Northern Caribbean University. In 2010, Mr. Horace Burnett joined the NCU family as a lecturer in the Visual Arts Department. He later became a lecturer in the Teacher Education Department and also served as Teaching Practicum Coordinator and a subcommittee chair and member of the International Literacy Conference. A tribute from the Dean of the College of Education and Leadership, the Chair of the Teacher Education Department, and the faculty and the staff of the college reads: we deeply sympathize with the family of Mr. Horace Burnett. We are extremely grateful for the competent, committed and consecrated service he rendered as a faculty of the Teacher Education Department. And the entire university family is no less thankful for the faithful and professional service that he provided. Though Mr. Burnett has gone to sleep, his impact will continue throughout the annals of time, as the lessons he taught his students will remain with them and with their descendants for as long as life shall last. To his beloved wife, Pamela, his children, Georgiana, Horace, and Camilla, his grandchildren, his other relatives and friends, and his former colleagues, even though you may mourn the death of your loved one, the Bible reminds us that death is but a sleep, and those who are faithful will rise to eternal life. On behalf of the Northern Caribbean University President, his administration, workers, and students, please accept our condolences.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Mark Shand, Dean of the Faculty of Pre- and Applied Sciences, Excelsior Community College. It is difficult at best to stand before you to attempt to honor my colleague's father in words. It is never an easy task to capture someone in speech, as word frequently falls short of capturing someone's true essence. In this instance, I'll make a brave attempt. Camilla remembers her father as being easygoing and a good listener. This attribute was clearly passed on to her as she describes her demeanor in her professional life and the manner how she executes her role as year coordinator. The gentleness that comes with those who she interacts is a clear reflection of the man she called dad. She remembers her dad as her hero, a proud dad of two daughters and a son. In her eyes, he was the most courageous and resourceful man. She never questioned if he loved and cared for his wife and children, because he demonstrated it. Her voice gently caressed his memory upon him taking his children to school and receiving an education. Not just any ordinary education, but a sound Christian education. A firm believer in the gospel of Christ, he took his children to many church trips. And you know, whenever there is a church trip, there is always the feeding of the 5,000. Daddy was an excellent cook, and Christmas cooking belonged to him. This man of God understood the assignment given to him by the Creator. He took his children to school religiously, a legacy that he left behind not only for his children, but for many of us who came in contact with him. On behalf of the Board of Management, the Committee of Management, or Principal Fillmore McCarthy, who is here, and senior managers of the institution, staff, students, we stand with you during this difficult moment. Camilla, your dad is merely sleeping. One sweet day in glory, you'll see him again. May your dad's soul rest in peace and perpetual light shine upon him.
You don't have to worry, and don't you be afraid. Joy comes in the morning, troubles they don't last always. For there's a friend in Jesus who will wipe your tears away. And if your heart is broken, just lift your hands and say, oh, I know that I can make it. I know that I can stand. No matter what may come my way, my life is in your hands. With Jesus, I can take it. Like a river attendeth my way. When sorrows like seas billows roar, whatever my lot,
Good afternoon, everyone. Like the many persons who preceded me, and no doubt those who will follow, it is with a profound sense of sadness that I stand to express condolences publicly on behalf of the elders of the Maranatha District of Churches and my family for my friend, brother, and mentor, Mr. Horace Burnett. Mr. Horace Burnett, Brother Burnett, Elder Burnett, Horace, as I would hear Sister Burnett call him, but I just say Elder B. And when I would say, "What's up, Elder B?" he would reply, "I am taking it easy, Brother Mac." I met Elder Burnett sometime in 1998 when I started visiting the Maranatha Seventh-day Adventist Church and was privileged to work alongside him whilst he was elder and then first elder. This quite unassuming, gentle giant was a man to be respected and admired. He was a thinker, a planner, a go-getter, yet a man of not many words. Brother B was more of a behind-the-scenes person, but you could bet your bottom dollar that he would complete the task and get the job done professionally with little or no talking and absolutely no fuss. Brothers and sisters, words and time would not allow me the opportunity to express the wealth of respect and admiration I have for this man. Elder B was a nation builder, as he not only served the church, but the nation as an educator, giving back to the young as well as the young at heart. He served his country and the church with unwavering commitment and professionalism. He was always willing to offer tremendous support and leadership in whatever capacity he was placed. His death will be a matter of enormous sadness to his family, those whom he knew, and those whose lives he impacted. Brothers and sisters, Elder Burnett was, he had a favorite one-liner that I liked. He would always say, "If you don't have anything good to say, please to shut your big mouth." And this is how I envisage the man. I see Brother Burnett as a soldier. And I see him leaving the trenches. He's still wearing his helmet. but he's removing his gloves. Because the war, the battle is over, but the war has just begun. Bon voyage, brave soldier. Hope to meet you on the other side.
I'm here to represent the Woodlawn Phase 2 Association, Citizens Association, for which Mr. Burnett was an active member. We cannot live alone for ourselves. 1,000 fiber connect us. Alone, we can do so little, but together, we can do so much. Mr. Burnett, no doubt, embraced that philosophy as he was a very active member of our community. He ensured that he was a part of all our activities. And he is one who worked behind the scene, but would ensure that things were done properly and on time. Mr. Burnett has left a void in our community which cannot be filled by anyone. To Pam and her children, the community express deep and heartfelt regret at his passing. Mr. Burnett touched so many lives in so many ways. And even though he has passed, his legacy lives on and impacts the lives in our community. Life is the only experience we know and can speak of. So when it's taken away from us, it creates great pain and sorrow. But Paul reminds us that if it is in this life we have hope, we are most miserable. So I know, along with ourselves, that Horace Burnett embraced the hope of a brighter tomorrow, the hope that was promised by our Savior, Jesus Christ. And so, Pam, on behalf of your family, on behalf of your friends, your neighbors, we express our heartfelt sympathy, and we look forward to that time when we will share good times, joyous times, unending, with Horace once more. Thank you.
Condolence to the Horace Burnett family and friends. On behalf of our director, Pastor Barrington McLean, our president, Sister Alicia Michelle, our vice president, and our members from the Manchester Lay Workers Federation. Elder Horace Burnett walked into our lives a few years ago and served as a member and soon elected to serve as treasurer of the Manchester Lay Workers Federation. After his reign had expired, an elected member, he continued to serve along with his wife, Sister Pamela Burnett, who has served in the Sabbath School unit of the Federation. Today, we're delighted to share the following message as it is entitled, The Dash. I read of a man who stood up to speak at a funeral of a friend. He referred to the dates on the tombstone from the beginning to the end. He noted that the first came the date of birth and spoke the following date with tears. But he said what mattered the most was the dash between those years. For that dash represents all the time one spends alive on earth. And now only those who love them know what that little line is worth. For it matters not how much we own, the car, the house, the cash. What matters is how we live and love and how we spend our dash. So think about this long and hard. Are there things you'd like to change? For you never know how much time is left that can be rearranged. If we could just slow down enough to consider what's true and real and always try to understand the way other people feel. And be less quick to anger, show appreciation more, and love the people in our lives like we have never loved before. If we treat each other with respect, and more often wear a smile, remembering that the special dash might only last a little while. So, when your eulogy is being read, with your life's actions to rehash, would you be proud of the things they say about how you spend your dash? Thank you as we continue to bless our Lord, Sister Pam.
To all our distinguished guests and the family especially, I want to say a very warm welcome and condolences to you all. We are gathered together because there's one that's missing. When someone is born and you hear there's a baby, we say congratulations and, you know, is it a boy, is it a girl? And sometimes we follow the life of the person. We want to see what this person is going to turn out to be. And sometimes as you watch them grow, you didn't see them for a few years. And then you saw them one day and it's like, oh my goodness, when did you get so big? What are you doing now? And we are proud of their accomplishment. And we go along with them in life. And then somewhere along the line, you might not see them for a few years. And you hear that there might be a doctor, a lawyer, Indian chief, something. And you say, oh, I remember when he was only 5 or when he was only 2 or something. But there's a road. It's a road. It's a road. And there's an end to the road. But importantly, I love the word of God. When it says that, fear God and give glory to him, because that's the whole duty of man. And when a life has been lived fearing God and giving glory to him, at the end of it you say hallelujah, amen. The sorrow is not for the one who sleeps in Christ. That's not the sorrow. The sorrow, and when we bawl out our belly button, is when a person had lived the life but did not come in contact with Jesus. Because, you know, it is done. Some years ago, I met Sister Burnett. She came to our office, and we had a beautiful relationship. We worked together as she worked on her health issues and everything, and as she enjoyed the beauty of God in our recovery. Every time she comes, she'd say, what about Oris? What you can do for Oris? And, you know, the care and concern that this wife had for her husband, it was really admirable. She's always wanting to ensure that he's okay. He's okay. So she keep asking, what can be done? Make sure. And the last time I spoke with Brother Oris, I told him that, listen to me, your wife wants to ensure that you're in good order, you know, you see, she's a young wife, so you have to ensure that you're well taken care of. So we have to work on this. And I like his demeanor. He's calm, very collected, not ruffled. And I admire that. I give God thanks for having met him. And thanks for the support that his wife had given and the way she wanted to ensure that he would have been with her. They're sitting in a rocking chair at the end of it, talking about the good old days. But the Lord knows best, and we have to trust our God, Sister Burnett, to take care of us. Sometimes the story doesn't end. It's only in storybook, and they live happily ever after. Only in storybook, it will stop right there. They don't tell about the death. But sometimes we are separated, but the saints of God will only sleep for a while. The saints of God. And you know what is the admonition for us now? Prepare ourselves. So that when that day of resurrection comes, you can say, hurry, I'm over here. And they say, oh, the fabulous, come, I'm here. Let's go meet Jesus. And then on. And with the family that he has blessed you with. Brethren, let us live for Christ. Let us live. If any of you here have not yet given your heart to Jesus, don't think you are losing. Sometimes persons think Christianity is boring. It is not. It is that happiness that comes from deep down in your belly bottom that nothing else in this life can ever come near. It is the most beautiful experience you'll ever have. So I would say, if you have not yet met Jesus, when you come to that end of the road, you're going to be filled with regret. If you have time, sometimes you don't. But if you prepare to meet him, oh, what a hallelujah morning that will be. God is waiting to take us home, to live forever and ever. Amen. Prepare for such a day. This life will be over, but a better one awaits us. And I say to the family, I know the loss. I lost my mother, and I know what it feels like. But you know what? The hope. Keep the hope burning, and Jesus will see you through. God bless you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Man Arthur. I know you have been sitting for a very long, long time. The next phase will be for the tributes, which will be led by another sweetheart, and then we'll try and run this through. Could I invite you all to stand straight for a few moments? Then you can be seated, and then we'll have Mrs. Theresa Richards from the Maranatha Church. Just stand straight for a little while, because based on what I'm seeing and how we are running the time, we have another 15, 20 minutes to go. All right. Deep breath, and you should be revived to continue until we are through. Thank you very much. The other sweetheart will now come.
It is an honor for me to present this tribute on behalf of our church family, the Maranatha Seventh-day Adventist Church, for our beloved Elder Horace Burnett. It is reasonable to say that for 40 years from the inception of the Maranatha Seventh-day Adventist Church until the time of his passing, Elder Burnett was an excellent team player, a dedicated officer of the church, and a shining example of a Christian leader. He served the church in various capacities, ranging from just being an involved member in all aspects of the church life to being an officer serving from 1983, when the Maranatha Church began. Vacation Bible School at Maranatha during the early years was a spectacular event, especially because of the benefits obtained from the input of our then art and craft specialist, Horace Burnett. Every child benefited tremendously from his teaching. I remember on one occasion when one child made a complete mess of his batik project. And when Elder Burnett saw it, he was shocked. He gave a little half smile and covered his mouth with one hand and said, "Oh my, this can't stay like this. Come, let me show you an easier way." And that he did. On the other hand, his approval of pieces that were well done would be readily seen by his broad smile, accompanied by his little jig or a little dance. In all the areas that he served, he displayed dedication, diligence, perseverance, determination, and integrity. He was very resourceful and never displayed a shade of selfishness. He was always willing to share the wealth of experience and knowledge that he had, especially with the leaders of the various departments of the church. As an elder, he served with distinction. He knew the members of the church and found time to visit them in their homes, especially to share in the various experiences, whether they had funerals, hospitalizations, graduations, weddings, whatever the occasion, his presence was felt. He possessed excellent interpersonal skills. He was an all-rounder, participating actively in work days, fun days, socials, and all the programs of the church. One would never know that he had a complete professional life outside of the church. And as for his family life, it was obvious to his church family that he was not only a good husband to his wife and friend Pamela, but one that was evidently caring and ever-present. It was also evident he was a godly father and grandfather to his children, Camelia, Georgian, and David, and his two grandsons. Though a firm and non-nonsense man, he was always pleasant and cordial. The Maranatha Seventh-day Adventist Church has lost one of its foundation members, a spiritual icon, one who exhibited energetic vibrancy, and one who lived according to his belief in the Word of God. A part of his motto is found in Isaiah 40, 31. But they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. His legacy will live on through his family and the impact he made on the various departments of the Maranatha Seventh-day Adventist Church. I thank you.
Officiating ministers, leaders of the church, Jamaica Union Conference, and the various conferences and educational institutions, Sister Pamela Burnett, and other members of the bereaved family, ladies and gentlemen, I stand here today, having once served as Elder Burnett's pastor, proud pastor, paying tribute to a life of consecration and commitment. After decades of dedicated service as an elder of Christ Church, Elder Burnett completed his mortal mission and now sleeps in the hope of resurrection morning. A man of faith, grit, and purpose. We miss him, his wisdom and goodness have blessed our lives for many years. Like the Apostle Paul, he has fought a good fight. He has finished his course and kept the faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for him a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give him at that day. And not to him only, but unto all of us also that love and look forward to his coming. Loida, Yulissa, and MJ, join me in expressing our love to his sweet wife, Pamela, children, grandchildren, immediate and extended families, or heartfelt condolences. Hold on. Joy comes in the morning.
To God be the glory.
great things he have done. So love he the world that he gave us his son. Praise the Lord. And to the church family who mourn the loss, immediate family, I share the blessings and I pray you'll be strengthened. I like the writer when he said, God is our refuge and strength and is a very present help in a time of trouble. In the midst of all circumstances, I want to encourage you. Oris is my brother, a very cool brother, very soft-spoken. But I want to say to you, the thing that I'm very happy for, our parents has laid a foundation. And they have invested in us, even when it were so rough, that we get good education. And not only good education, make sure the Christian principle was embedded in us. I want to thank God. And for Aureus, I want to say he has gone. Immediate family, take up the legacy, carry through. Don't let what he has sown died. Reap, and when you reap, replant. And I want to say to us all today, be strong and be courageous. We are living in earth's most serious time. The only source of strength is Jehovah God. Jesus, who is the way, the truth, and the life. Put your trust in him. Live for him. Because his purpose as he came to give us life and to give it unto us more abundantly. I want to thank God for everyone. I want to thank God for the saints from St. Thomas who come along with me and give me that kind of support that I don't faint on the way. They hold me up. So God bless you, St. Thomas. And I want to say I migrate from St. Elizabeth. But I just want to give you a little story. When I went to St. Thomas, and they said to me, if I drink the river water, I will never go back to St. Elizabeth. And it looked like a trophy too. So I want to wish you all the best. And friends, let us keep the fire burning wherever you go. Don't let the light go out at your altar in your church. Keep the fire burning. And let us discover Jamaica for Jesus once and for all. We can do it. You can do it. And with Christ in us, I can do all things through Christ that strengthened me. God bless you. Love you all.
Except the Lord build the house, they labor in vain that built it. Except the Lord keep the city, the watchman waketh but in vain. It is in vain for you to rise up early, to sit up late, to eat the bread of sorrows. For so he giveth his beloved sleep. Lo, children are an heritage of the Lord, and the fruit of the womb is his reward. As arrows are in the hand of the mighty man, so are children of the youth. Happy is the man that hath his quiver full of them. They shall not be ashamed, but they shall speak with the enemies in the gate.
Daddy began planting his garden in March of 1984. He developed a three-step checklist to prepare his fertile garden for a successful season. Preparing the shed, he placed the fertilizer, manure, tools, and seeds where they were easily retrieved. He then cleared the weeds, mulch, and debris. Using the tiller, he worked the soil to loosen it up and began early planting on July 31, 1980. He planted three seeds, that of Camellia, Georgian, and Horace Jr. He graciously nurtured us throughout our lives from conception to adulthood with fresh air of love, watering care, and tender sunshine. His life epitomized that of a great priest, provider, and protector, ensuring that we were always properly clothed, fed, and had a warm and comfortable bed to sleep in. His assistance in our academic and spiritual achievement was of paramount importance to him. While he was nurturing the garden, weeds of illness affected the growth of the buds, that of myself at birth and my sister at adolescence. He always encouraged us to forge ahead with our life goals and live for Jesus. In times of drought, he watered the garden with the words of Solomon, ensuring that he would always acknowledge God, the master gardener, so growth would be enhanced. He continued to till the soil with morning and evening family worship, avid supporter of Christian education, as he introduced us to the Word of God. Some of Daddy's favorite expressions would be,
"Mercy, Lord! Matsya, how does a fella take so long to charge? Pick me! Leave me alone!"
Daddy was always a patient and easygoing person, but he would become very impatient when teaching us mathematics.
"Pinkney, why you won't learn the maths? Maths is something you have to practice daily."
Daddy was fun-loving, kind-hearted, compassionate, knowledgeable, open-minded, great listener, and so many other adjectives can be used to describe this notable man. He always had a pleasant countenance, even on his worst days. Always had an approachable demeanor, because absolutely nothing bothered Daddy. We would always look forward to church trips with a packed blue igloo and straw basket, not to mention Christmas dinner. He was the head cook and buckle washer with his favorite curry goat, gunga rice and peas, and not to mention the sorrel. His favorite sports were track and field, basketball, and cricket, and he loved to watch school challenge quiz. And his commentary on these were very comical. You would hear him say, "Pick me, run girl, run, run girl." And you sit at the edge of his seat, "Run girl, yes, Erica, run, run." That was Daddy.
Daddy constantly pruned the soil through prayer and study of the Word of God and having a personal relationship with Him. To continue enhancing our spiritual well-being, Daddy made sure we never missed a vacation Bible school, Sunday and Wednesday night meeting, choir practice, and Pathfinder Club meeting. Today, as we gather to bid Him farewell, we remember His laughter, His embrace, and His care. Our Dad's memory and His name will live on, rooted within our hearts. A garden of love that forever blooms because of you.
The life you lived has impacted many greatly.
we will endeavor that the legacy you have left for your children and grandchildren will live on.
We love you, Daddy, Big Belly, Poopa, Pops. See you on that great getting up morning.
I invite the congregation to stand while we sing this song, I Need Thee Every Hour. Every hour, most precious Lord, tender voice like thine can peace afford. I need thee, oh, I need thee, every, oh, I need thee, oh, bless me now, my Savior, I come to thee. I need thee, every hour, stay. Congregation to remain standing while the family members are seated as we pray. O God, O help in ages past, O help for years to come, or shelter from the stormy blast, and our eternal home. Father, we are gathered here today in this auditorium, not because we want to. Our hearts are bent down with sorrow, and our eyes are filled with tears because the enemy death struck once again. But Lord, we do know that in the midst of everything, we have Jesus. Because Jesus, you are the greatest comforter of all. And even though at times we may try our best to comfort each other, yet we know that there is no one like Jesus. And so we call upon you now, Jesus, great comforter, sustainer, that you will come and cover the family members. Oh, Father, how painful it is to have lost a loved one. But I just ask you to just put your arms of love around them, embrace them, and let them know that everything will be all right. Because one day Jesus has promised that he will return. One day the grave will be opened and your people will come forth. Lord, we do know that some will come forth to the resurrection of damnation, but some will come forth to the resurrection of life. Because Jesus, you have said, I am the resurrection and the life. Though that believe in me, though they were dead, yet shall they live. So we put the family members in your hand. Just cover everyone within hearing of my voice in this congregation. We look forward, Lord, with great anticipation when there will be no more death. There'll be no more sorrow. There'll be no more pain. For the former things have passed away. We look forward for the day when we will meet our loved ones again. Until then, we say, let us keep on singing. Let us keep on praying. Let us keep on looking to Jesus, who is the author and finisher of our faith. We thank you for hearing our prayers. We thank you, Lord, for covering us with your robe of righteousness. We ask all these and we thank you now in the mighty name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen and amen.
Good afternoon, everyone. It is a good thing to give thanks. On behalf of Ms. Pamela Burnett and family, I bring special thanks and appreciation to everyone present here, both in person and online. Your presence has been an encouragement to our hearts and is well needed in this difficult time. We deeply appreciate the numerous overflowing of your love shown in your visits, calls, gifts, and your earnest prayers. Heaven has certainly recorded your kindness. We are thankful to all participants in this event and for contributing to the smooth flow of this service. Thanks to Northern Caribbean University, and in particular, the Teacher Education Department, TED, for spearheading the planning and execution of this event through the leadership of Dr. Jacqueline Austin Clark. We sincerely appreciate the support of the Maranatha SDA Church family, Mrs. Valdebuckle, Complete Healing, NCU Media, NCU Press, Dr. Harden, Central Flower Shop, 3T Catering Services, Mrs. Bobbitt Coke and her team, NCU Custodial Services, NCU CCMPR Department, Dr. Marilyn Anderson, Jamaica Union Conference of SDA, Central Jamaica Conference of SDA, WIC Prep School, the NCU Department of Humanities, and Lynn's Funeral Home. Finally, let's give God thanks for his healing and guidance and for having shared Mr. Horace Burnett, my dear uncle, with you. We are grateful to God for the plan of redemption that affords us the opportunity to unite with our loved one once again. Thank you, one and all, and may God bless you abundantly.
The song that will be used to close this wonderful Thanksgiving service is "How Sweet Are the Tidings." At the end of the second stanza, the platform party will leave, take its position down the aisle. On their way out, they will be followed by the casket, which will be followed by the members of the immediate family, to be followed by the rest of the congregation. The processional will be guided by police outriders. Behind the outriders will be a marked police vehicle. Behind that vehicle will be the officiating pastors, followed by the hearse, followed by the members of the immediate family, followed by the rest of us. The route will be as follows: down Manchester Road to Grove Road, from Grove Road to Perth Road, down Perth Road to Manchester High School, bearing left along the Greenvale Road, up beyond the roundabout to Hatfield Square, where we will make a right on to the place of interment, that's the Oaklawn Memorial Gardens. If you forget all of that, follow the hearse. There will be a repast that follows. The repast will be at St. Mark's Church Hall. That's in the vicinity of the market. The entrance is near Irville Supermarket. That road? Or you drive along Manchester High School, but there's a gate that closes off. So I figure that you need to drive on the Manchester Road back gate, the Manchester High School back gate. If you can't follow that, follow me.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. Today, I should have been here much earlier. Had some car challenges, but praise God, I'm here. Dr. Milton Gregory fitted in for me nicely. And so I am taking over the last part where Dr. Gregory should make the benediction and so on. My name is Thomas Bryan, Thomas Hurricane Bryan. I used to be the minister of the Maranatha Church, Maranatha Circuit. And whenever we would have some little challenge or challenges here and there, one person would disagree, the other would agree, Elder Burnett was always the peacemaker. He was a wonderful gentleman. He was my counselor. He was my confidant. He was a great family man, a great church elder. Loved his children, Camilla, Georgian, Horace, Junior, and the grandchildren. He lived a powerful life, a wonderful life, and I praise God for him. And I only want to say to you Dr. Cheyenne O'Connor, we will consider both the judgment and the resurrection. May I ask you to stand, please? Oh, gracious Father, we thank you for lending Elder Horace George Burnett Sr. to us. You have seen it fit to allow him to lay down the burdens of this life. Oh God, we anticipate the great resurrection morning, when the dead in Christ shall not only rise, but rise first. We thank you for the service in his honor, but more so a service to glorify your name. We thank you for lending him to us. And now I pray that you may watch over us, watch over his family, immediate family, nuclear, work family, church family. We are all mourning, but we do not mourn like those who have no hope. We anticipate the day when you shall cause this place to rupture and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Keep us until then, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. How sweet are the tidings. Come on. How sweet that greet the pilgrim air as he in glory appear, and soon will the kingdom, everybody sings, it's coming, coming soon, I coming back to this earth. And wait, pilgrims, well to glory, when the Savior comes to reign. Oh, grave with a pallbearers, please take up your position at this time.